welcome to the epic, awesome show, Anime Podcast number 178. I'm Zain, and along with me is for a new special person. And would you like to introduce yourself?
I am the one and only King Koopa. I don't know about that term that everyone loves, but I am the original King Koopa. Nice to meet you, man.
Nice. So, we have the lovely King Koopa here. He's going to come in, and unfortunately, he's going to be replacing Scotty Oka. Unfortunately, just a lot of different stuff happening with him. So, yeah. So, happy to have you on the show, and happy to bring you on, man.
Hey, man, it's great to be here, man. It's been a while since I've talked to you, so it's glad to be remembered.
Oh, yeah. It's been like, what, since, I would say since Anime Austin?
Like,
or CTX. I think it was CTX. CTX
was the last time when we, like, hung out.
Yeah. That's the only thing that really sucks is, like, we're in the same city, but we just never hang out.
We live, like, on the opposite ends of the same city, so it's, like, drive
that
to each other's house would be, like, an hour and a half.
That is true. You live on the south side, I live on the north side, so that doesn't really help anything. And I live on the way, the farthest part, I think one of the farthest parts of, the north side, too, so that doesn't help anything.
Yes, you do. Yeah, you do.
So, let's kind of get this started here. Let's get this started here with a little bit of talking about some of the anime that we watched this week. Yeah! Not sure what exactly you've watched, been watching.
So, a lot of my, like, anime that I've been catching up on as far as recently, I've been doing a lot of rewatching. So, Not a lot of like recent rewatches. Like, so I'm rewatching The Devil's a Part-Timer because I genuinely enjoyed every ounce of that anime. For shits and giggles, I'm kind of watching Soul Eater. But I also started someone caught me onto one. What is it? It's called like Inuyashiki. I'm not 100% sure what's going on in that one, but
Inuyashiki.
Every clip I see of it, I see, like, a kid with, like, he's doing, like, finger guns, like, bang, bang with your finger.
You're talking about, it's not that,
What is it called?
Oh, my goodness.
I don't know what it's called.
I mean, what you, Yu Yu Hakusho.
No, it's not Yu Hakusho. It's, like, It's not Yu Hakusho. It's actually called it Inuyashiki. But, like, I don't know how to explain it, but yeah, it's something along those. It's like Death Note's kind of attitude with like.
Okay. Yeah, it's one of the newest ones that came out.
Yeah, I think it came out like in October, and then so today I tried to watch A Sister's All You Need, and I'm not sure if I'm gonna continue watching.
I am
so upset about that one.
Yeah. I mean, there's one time where, what's his face? He was trying to get me to watch this one show that was, like, last season. And I watched the first episode of it, and it was just, no. my goodness, can't remember the name of the show. James tried to get me to watch it so many times. It's a very lesbian and becomes very bi-lesbian relationship where it's just really weird. With high schoolers?
I don't know. It's so
vague.
I don't
know the name of the show. It's like, what, any anime?
Yeah.
For the past 15 years?
Yeah. But yeah, no, that's kind of so far as my anime watching has been going. I've been playing a lot more video games than I have been watching anime.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of the same with me. I mean, I know it's the fact that, you know, I do the anime podcast and, you know, I'm supposed to be watching anime all the time. And I don't. It's terrible. Like, this last few times, I've just been really bad about watching a lot of anime. But
man, like, I'm telling you, like, I don't know. It's not that it's hard to watch anime. It's become easier to just play video games. So I've been doing a whole lot of that.
Oh, yeah. Like, I've been playing a crap ton of video games as well. I mean, kind of going into that a little bit. I think we can actually veer into that, like, talking about video games. We can talk about the Video Games Awards 2017.
Oh, yeah.
Let's
talk about that.
Yeah. Kind of going into that. I mean, I'll go back into talking about the anime that I've watched this week as well. Actually, that's what I put in for the thing. I never actually went into the actual thing to the actual website and everything else, because I actually had everything personally right there. So one of the so let's get this out of the way. The first thing here is Game of the Year this year was none other than Breath of the Wild, Legend of Zelda, and I definitely see why.
Yeah, no, I was 100% behind that. Like, don't get me wrong, I'm still playing Breath of the Wild. I finished Odyssey. I couldn't get into Battlegrounds Unknown. Zero Dawn actually kind of bored me, and I haven't played Persona yet. So out of all the ones I actually played, Breath of the Wild, hands down, I'm actually okay with that. I'm actually okay with that option.
Oh, yeah. I mean, Breath of the Wild is what, like, if you play it 100%, I think it takes you, what, like, over 100 hours to beat it?
Oh, my God. It's infuriating how much there's to do in the game. Like, Bethesda, step your game up. Like, Fallout had a lot to do, but, oh, my God, Nintendo was like, we got you.
Yeah.
You have plenty to do in Breath of the Wild.
Yeah. And that's something that I think a lot of people that love Zelda, you know, and love this new title is the fact that it's hard, but it's just so much to do, and it, you know, get better as you go, and it's a really good challenge with it, too.
Yeah. Like, personally, for me, I am a sucker for small details. So, like, little stuff like it's cold, so you take damage. Like, little stuff like that gets to me. Like, one of my favorite things about the game is, like, you know how you can cook recipes in pots, right? Or, like, you find, like, a pan and, like, you can put together food for recipes. You can also just drop, like, raw meat on an open fire and it'll cook. And that tickles me for some reason. Like, I think that is hilarious. Like, little things like that just, I'm a sucker for it. So, like, all the little things that this game did were enough to, like, win me over.
Yeah. I mean, was it worth the wait, though? Because we never got one on the Wii U. We never got a Zelda title.
Yes, it felt polished. It felt polished. Felt like a labor of love. It didn't feel like it was rushed.
Which is
It felt like it took the time.
Yeah, which is a weird thing, too, because it's a game that doesn't have to be patched.
Not even a little. Like,
and
there might,
like,
be one or two bugs,
to have that
but
feeling
it's very
now.
Rare.
Yeah. With, like, most games now, you look at any type of game, you know, whether it be Call of Duty or even you can go look at Overwatch or mainstay titles, there's a lot of issues at launch.
You are preaching to the choir. I, like, a lot of people disagree with me when I say this, but I'm a huge Bethesda fan. And from, like, a technological standpoint, Bethesda usually drops the ball pretty hard. Like, they can release some buggy games. And I can agree that they will release a buggy game. Like, do you remember when Fallout 4 first came out? Oh, my God. I needed so many patches. But, like, you know, I'm still a fan. Like, hopping in immediately, like, I have yet to have an issue with that game. I have yet to have an issue with Breath of the Wild at all.
Nice. Which is actually a very good accomplishment, because even for me, like, you look at a game like The Last of Us, playing through that game originally, I could never give that game a perfect score, even though I really wanted to. I ran into a bug in the game, like, where I could not play. Like, it was almost a game-breaking bug, because it was, like, in the snow scene with Ellie, and you're controlling Ellie, and you can't see, like, everything glitched. Like, I had never seen that before, and
there's a YouTuber, and I can't think of his name right now, but he made a statement that I 100% agreed with. It was like, Nintendo doesn't know anything about customer service, they don't know anything about PR, but the one thing they know how to do is make a good game, and I agree with that 100%.
Oh, yeah. That's the one thing I have to admit about Nintendo and what they do and their business that they deal with and their business model that they use, the fact that they're very innovative and they're not afraid to take a chance on something, even if it's going to fail horribly.
Yeah. Which, and let's be realistic. They were – this whole idea, like the whole Switch was a gamble. Like, it wasn't as big of a gamble as they, like, portrayed it to be, but it was a big enough gamble that you could tell, like, this was a make-or-break thing, because they tried with the Wii did it, and all right, the Wii U did maybe a little less than all right, and then this one kind of brought them back home.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, the Switch is like, you can play the game on the go. Who doesn't want to play their favorite Nintendo games on the go?
I've legit, for the past month, I forgot that I could play my Switch on the TV, and I literally just playing it as a handheld. Legit just forgot. Like, oh, yeah, that's what this dock is for. I was wondering what that was for.
Yeah, but I mean, I could totally see that being a thing, because it's like, oh, man, I got my new handheld, the Switch, not really, because it's probably got its own, because you can actually just plug it straight into the wall, right?
Yeah, the way it works is like the mount itself has a plug spot and an HDMI port, but the plug that goes into the wall very much just plugs into the bottom of the Switch itself. Yeah. So at the end of the day, you never actually need to plug it into your TV. It's more just a plus that you can do.
Yeah, and also for the Game Awards too is Persona 5 won Best Role Playing Game of the Year, which. You know, I think that's actually legit really cool, especially for anybody who's a big Persona fan that loves the Persona games. The game itself looked really good for what I got to see of it being played. I mean, it was that Persona's never one of the games that was just never got to me. I've never really sat down and played a Persona game.
I keep telling myself to play Persona 5 because I've yet to hear anything bad about it. But yeah. Only because I haven't played it. I'm not sure how I feel about that. Because, again, it went up against South Park, The Fractured Butthole, and Final Fantasy XV. Now, Fractured Butthole was amazing. I loved it. I've replayed it twice. I enjoy every joke, every segment. I enjoy the enhanced battle system, like the remix that they did from the last one. Like, I liked all the little tweaks. And Final Fantasy XV... I feel like I'm the only person on this planet that enjoyed that game. Like, every other person's like, oh, God, Final Fantasy XV. I'm like, I loved it. So I can understand how, Final Fantasy didn't win. But I haven't played Persona, so maybe it really is better than South Park. But South Park was a good RPG, like, hands down.
I mean, but granted, though, when it's South Park, for most people, anybody who's a fan of the show, I think just love the games anyways just because of how close they are to the show.
Even still, though, as a role-playing game, it was really sharp. It was really put together. I had no issues with it. The battle system was its own.
The level difficulty I thought was kind of funny, though.
Yeah, no, like, even from, like, the levels where, like, you had to move across the field at a certain pace. Yeah. Like, those were met with challenge. It felt solid. Like, I had no problem with it. So I literally just have to play Persona 5 to play something better.
Yeah. And... of course, you know, the best sports racing game was Forza Motorsport 7. And you know, that's not a big shock there, I mean.
It's not, but the ironic part is I literally downloaded it today. I was going to play it this afternoon as soon as we get off. But I usually try to stay away from Motorsport because Motorsport is, again, a racing sim. And I'm not usually a racing sim kind of guy. But I figured I'd give it a chance because I genuinely do enjoy the Horizon series. So we'll see how that goes tonight.
Yeah, which is actually really cool because also for Game of the Year as well, nominated because I'm actually looking at the nominations now. Super Mario Odyssey was also in there too, which is really kind of cool. The fact that it just came out and I'm surprised it got nominated this year too.
Man.
I know everyone's been praising it as being like a really good game, and I guarantee it probably is a really good game. But
there's a chart that I think Nintendo has where they have like all the Mario games rated from like good to best, and like their top ones are like 64, Sunshine, and they put Odyssey along the lines with Sunshine. Everyone was like, okay, that's a big claim, and. Frankly, it was a fair claim. Like, that game's...
Yeah.
That I haven't enjoyed playing a Mario game like that in a while. Like, I don't enjoy Mario games at all. Like, that's not my thing. Like, it's been a... Like, 64 was the last time I picked up a Mario game and went, ooh, I want to keep playing this. Nah, Odyssey, I enjoy. I genuinely...
Yeah.
I finished...
Wow. 100%?
Not 100. I'm at the very... final boss. Like there's a second ending. There's a second ending. I'm doing the second ending now. So,
nice.
I'm like 99% done.
Nice, nice. Because also, it was also going up against Horizon Zero Dawn. Wow, I couldn't even speak that out. Which I heard that's a really good game. It's a game I've yet to play. And it's a PlayStation exclusive, and I really should play it.
I'm trying. I want to give it a chance, but like every little bit of it I get into, like I've checked it out.
Yeah.
I've done research, and then I'm like, I should try to play it, but it doesn't grasp me. It doesn't grab me as something I'm going to enjoy playing. So I've just kind of, I've been on the fence on that one. But you know, you don't know until you actually try it.
Yeah. Also, as well, best narrative was Hellblade. Was there Horizon Zero Dawn, of course. Nier Automata. What Remains of the Edith Finch and Wolfenstein 2. And What Remains of the Edith Inch... Finch. Not Inch. Finch. That actually probably changes the thing a little bit there. But Edith the one Finch. Thing I kind of want to talk... Yeah. Actually, I have no idea what that game is, though.
I am with you. Like, I'll be honest with you. Out of those five games... The one I played was Wolfenstein.
Yeah. So, talking about this, too, as well, best art direction. In this was Cuphead, Destiny 2, Horizon Zero Dawn, Persona 5, and Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild. And Cuphead won. To be honest with you, I would say the weakest out of that category was Destiny. Was one of the weakest ones.
Because Destiny is very much one of those games that starts to feel repetitive. Even the second one, they added a story to the second one. It still felt repetitive.
But nothing really stood out as the art direction on it. It just felt like, oh, this is just another Destiny game. It's just okay.
Yeah, it felt like Destiny 1, but with a story.
Yeah. Persona 5, I could see I could have seen that easily winning, but Cuphead, I'm actually absolutely happy that Cuphead won it because the art style is such a great art style. I love the art style.
The thing for me is I like to see underdogs win. So just the fact that this is an indie company that they made this game from scratch. And I have it, I have not beaten it, but every time I play it, as much of a headache as that game is, love it still. I love that game. I love the art, I love everything about it.
Oh yeah, I would love to see the only game on PS4 though.
Like as many rewards as they won, the only game I would have given a second was Breath of the Wild because I do like that cell shading kind of idea that they had going on. But Cuphead, hands down, won.
Which is interesting though. You talk about the Breath of the Wild. You talk about Cuphead, and you kind of talk about Mario Odyssey. And one thing that's really kind of interesting about those games is that those games are going to age absolutely phenomenally well. Same thing with Persona 5 as well.
Agree. Well, I don't know about Persona because I haven't played it, but I see where you're going. I was agreeing, all three of them will age perfectly. I'm assuming it's Persona as well. Like it'll age perfectly. I can see down the line wanting to play these games later with my kid or something like that.
I mean, not even just playing it with your kid, but it also, when you go farther, when technology gets better and better and better, and we're seeing, better realistic games don't really age well.
No.
For the most part, because they look like crap after, you go back and play the old GoldenEye, and man, that game looks like crap.
It
looks bad.
A good example, Max Payne. When was the last time someone played the original Max Payne?
Yeah.
That's a good example right there of them trying to make it look super realistic. Like, those games tend to fall off after, some odd year. Like, I don't see Grand Theft Auto 5 aging super well once the current console generation leaves.
Yeah.
Like, once we're on to the next one, we're going to want a 6. Mm-hmm. We're not going to want to play 5 again. Like, when was the last time anyone actively wanted to go play Grand Theft Auto 3?
And maybe if they have they only have that console, man.
Yeah, that's it though. But this man in this chair who has every current console iteration, I personally would not go back and play Grand Theft Auto 3 at all.
Oh, yeah.
I might play San Andreas because I actually like the story to that game. But No.
Yeah. Not no, it's definitely, it's like, it definitely is the, like, any of the games there that have that look to them, that, like, Overwatch has it, has that cartoon look to it. You look at Team Fortress 2.
Oh, yeah.
That game has aged phenomenal. Yeah, and it they really haven't even updated the graphics on it. They may have updated the graphics on it, maybe, a little bit. But
like, a slight tweak just for, like, the the 4K people, but that's about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Nothing too spectacular, but it still has a fan base. And it still looked just as good when it came out, I would say, like, 10-plus years ago at this point.
Yeah.
Like about 10 years ago, I think it's when it came out, but...
just about,
it's like, yeah, because it's with those games, and the one thing I like about Nintendo is a lot of their games age well. A lot of their 3D games
at least, like,
age well.
They're Nintendo. They're very Nintendo specific games. Like,
yeah,
their game was made by like Sega or the few third party people they do work with. Usually don't last very long, but anything made by Nintendo will last a lifetime.
Oh yeah. I mean, it's just, I don't know what it is, but what it is about it. And I think it's a lot of times it has to do with the graphics that they choose to use. And a lot of times, yeah, they use 3D, they may, you know, update to HD, but even you look at the new Smash Brothers, that's going to probably age super well still because of the cartoon element of it.
Well, there's an idea that, like, people react very well to colors. It's almost like a childlike reaction. So people, like, those colors, those pop, those grab your attention for extended periods of time. But like, so you're gonna remember things like, you know, Super Mario 64, which was super bright and colorful. Or even like the classic Smash Bros. Just stuff that grabbed your attention super like immediately. You're gonna remember games like that. So, you know, like I said, Odyssey, Breath of the Wild, Cuphead, they're all really colorful. They're all really grasping as far as, like, attention goes. So, yeah, they're gonna remain classic.
Oh, yeah, definitely. And plus, on top of that, it not only do they have to look good, but they have to play really well, too, for them to really last, have that lasting impression on us. And that's one thing that you guarantee with Nintendo, that seal of approval on it from Nintendo itself, is it's going to more than likely be as polished as it possibly could be, and then some.
Yeah, agreed.
And it's just like, it's what you expect from it, but also what you really expect from Nintendo is family titles. And best family game at was actually kind of funny, because not only did it have Mario Kart 8, Mario Kart plus Rabbids, Kingdom Battle, Sonic Mania, Splatoon 2, and Super Mario Odyssey. So basically, out of four out of five, they had that category.
Yep, they
Super
they
Mario
had
Odyssey won, but
down. They had that. They had it locked down from the beginning.
Which is still kind of cool, though, that you have Sega there too, and the best family game too. I think that's actually kind of a cool thing, but also kind of shows you where Nintendo is and where Sega is.
Another thing is, it's also kind of pointing out how prominent indie game companies are, because a lot of these categories, like even this one, has, because Sonic Mania, while it was developed by Sonic or Team Sonic, Sonic Team, whatever you want to call them, Sega, the people they pulled aside to make this game were just, you know, fans. The guy who did the opening trailer for it was an animator who was just a fan of Sonic. The guy who originally did the coding for it did a patch or a mod for the Game Boy Advance version of the original Sega the Hedgehog. So, like, these are modders and fans and, you know, people who are just trying to make a name for themselves actually doing so. So, like, I applaud those guys. Even if they didn't win the award, I applaud those guys for the work that they did.
Yeah.
That's all I can say.
Yeah, definitely. It's like they did a really good job on it. Now, looking at the most anticipated game of the year, the game of the year was God of War, which I think a lot of people are looking forward to the new God of War. And probably seeing the, you know, goddess boobies, I mean, more than likely.
Yeah.
Marvel's Spider-Man. Monster Hunter World, Red Dead Redemption 2, and I think by far, by far though, The Last of Us Part 2, I'm excited for it. I am super excited for this, which I'm actually kind of surprised it's not even on this list, is Kingdom Hearts 3.
Because I feel like most people like myself have just given up and just, we'll see when it comes out. I'm not going to give that game any more hype. I refuse to give that game any more hype at all.
Yeah. This is very true. I mean, it's like supposed to I think it's supposed to come out next year.
Yeah, sure. I believe that when I see it.
I think it actually does have a solid release date, I believe.
Okay.
I think.
No,
it does not have a solid release date yet. Nope. It does not. It has initial release date is 2018, so let's see if that happens.
Yeah, so I'll believe it when I see it.
Yeah.
I will say one thing that made me laugh, at least on the... No, I laughed pretty hard on the outside, too. Best strategy game was won by Mario plus Rabbids, which is basically just XCOM with Mario and Rabbids, which basically means the copy beat the original, because XCOM 2 was also for that reward. And I think that's hilarious, because as much as I love Mario, you cannot get me to buy a Rabbids game. But I do like XCOM, so I am very conflicted right now.
Be like, should I buy this? I do not like Rabbids.
I like
Mario.
Really, I like
XCOM.
Part of me really wants to buy that game, because I do like the XCOM style strategy. But I cannot, for the life of me, buy a Rabbids game. I can't do it. So I'm really conflicted. And it just kills me that they beat out XCOM 2, which originated that type of strategy. And I'm just like, come on now. that's just mean.
And also, as well, too, because we could talk about this as well, the best debut indie game, and by far this year, was definitely Cuphead. And they won hands down.
Hands down.
I think it was the most anticipated game. I was anticipating this game. I wanted to play this game since I saw it at E3.
I was anticipating this game since I saw it at E3. In like 2015 or 20, I don't remember if it was 2015 or 2014.
It was either one of those 2 years. I mean, it's been in development for a while, but it's like one of those.
The hype was so real because they didn't push it. They were like, "Hey, we're working on this game," and then just went silent for a year.
Yeah.
And like 2 years later, they're like, "Hey, heads up, we're still working on this game," and then go silent again. And then earlier this year, they're like, "Oh yeah, by the way, we're done."
Yeah.
So, like, applaud, because I was so ready for this game, and the hype was not too much. Because too much hype can kill a game, hands down.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I think we've seen that, like, numerous times what game was it?
Oh, No Man's Sky.
No Man's Sky was definitely a good game that was way overhyped. It just not as good as it. There was another game, too, that was, like, I thought was just way overhyped. Mighty No. 9 was the other game that was literally that game, man. That game is infuriating.
No.
I bought the game and I still can't beat the game because I was dumb and but like, oh, I'm gonna go with 3 lives.
I'm telling
Shoot
you,
me
man.
Now.
Hype kills games, man. Hype kills game. Another one, Watch Dogs, the first one. Like, all the hype behind what that game just ruined it. If I ever become a game developer, I'm just going to undersell my game all the time and just hope that, you know, the right people play it and they're like, he's lying, this game is amazing.
Yeah. So, also coming in next year, for anime-wise... is probably one of my favorite shows from watching when I was a kid here, is Cardcaptor Sakura is coming back with a new anime.
Yeah, I saw that, and I was super surprised about that.
It comes out on January 7th, 2018, and it's premiering on Crunchyroll. And Funimation will stream the dub on Funimation now, so it's going to not only get that, but it's going to get a dub possibly from Funimation. How much better can this possibly get?
I second you, but I'm not going to lie to you. There's one anime coming out next year that I genuinely am ready for. That I've been ready for it when they announced it last year. I'm ready for it to come out next year. FLCL Part 2. That is my anime I'm waiting for.
Oh, Fully Cooly?
Yes. Oh my god. I am so ready for Fully Cooly Part 2.
Does that come out this year?
That is scheduled. That is slated for 2018.
Huh. I'm not sure if it's part of the I don't know what lineup that's actually part of.
I'm 100% sure it's Toonami. I'm pretty sure it's going straight to Toonami. But
it might be too.
That's fine with me. I am so ready for that. I don't care where they stream it. I'm going to be watching it.
Be like TVR that. Ha.
Man, I haven't TVR'd something in so long. There's like a couple things I've TVR'd.
Yeah.
FLCL. I'm going to be home whenever FLCL is premiering, or wherever I am, I'm going to be watching it.
Be like at a con. Be like, excuse me, I gotta go to the room. Fully Cooly's on.
Yep.
And
yep,
my
I
way.
Will be knocking you and James over to get back to my hotel room.
Not even just us and James. I mean, if you have an old lady there on a scooter, he's gonna go. Wah! Oh,
she shouldn't be. She picked a wrong time to be in front of me on a scooter.
But also, what's really cool too is Studio Trigger is coming back with another anime next year, which I'm looking forward to because it's Studio Trigger and. I'm just
right.
A fanboy for Studio Trigger.
Puts out good stuff.
Oh yeah, is Darling in the Franxx, and that one looks really good. And it's actually a project between Trigger and A1 Pictures, so.
Oh.
Not sure exactly how a lot of people are going to feel about that one because you know some people have issues with A1, especially with Sword Art, you know, all that stuff there. But especially if it's mostly in the style of Trigger. Then I think it's going to be very enjoyable. That's the one thing I like about Studio Trigger's stuff, is that a lot of their stuff is very fluid motions. I think that's, like, the best part about it.
Yeah, I kind of agree with you. I feel like if it's more towards Studio Trigger, I'll probably check it out more.
Oh.
Otherwise, I might steer clear just because I'll forget.
Yeah.
Like, Trigger's animation style is one of those that even if you do forget the name of it, you remember it's them. And that's very much appreciated, I both.
Yeah. Which is actually really interesting, because they did when supernatural powers become commonplace, too.
Yeah.
And you look at that art style. That art style isn't really... It looks like a normal anime. It doesn't look like Studio Trigger did it. Until you actually start noticing different little quirks that Studio Trigger does do. And then it starts making sense that, oh... Studio Trigger, that's definitely Studio Trigger. Because we watched it again, and was going like, wait, Studio Trigger did this? I don't believe this. I don't believe this at all. And then it's like, okay, I see it.
Yeah. There's supposed to be more of Seven Deadly Sins next year. And I kind of hate admitting to people I enjoy that show.
Because, are you kidding me, dude? I absolutely love that show, man.
Like, I try not... I try not to have too many, like, otaku friends, but the few that I do have just hate me for enjoying that show. And I'm like, why? It's not that bad.
The thing is, the show is very enjoyable. It's dumb. It's stupid.
It is.
And
it's very...
that's the one best part of the show. And that's kind of the reason why I like it. Like, I don't have to watch it. Like, I don't always want to watch an anime that's very going to make me think and make me like, oh, this is really good. I just want one that can just turn my brain off
and enjoy. I want something dumb. I want something dumb every now and then.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of shows that I watch that are just like, I shouldn't like this show, but I really like it. Like, My First Girlfriend as a Gal is one of those shows that you would think that I would not like because it has a lot of fan service in it. But there's something about it. It's either the characters or how it was done. I don't know exactly what it is. But there's something about it that I just love so much. So it's just like,
Have you heard of – someone sent me one. I have no idea. I know nothing about it. But it's something called Time Driver.
Time Driver.
And I
have
no idea what it is. It's slated to come out next year as well in March. But I can't tell you what it's about. I don't know what it is. It's weird. I was hoping you would know something about that one.
I don't know, but, like, I granted, I'm, like, anime. Because it's like, I gotta look at this. Oh, no. There we go. Time Driver, it might be also, because this one might be also Amazon Prime, too. I'm not sure on this one. Because there's a few things that are becoming Amazon Prime only, so that, you know, it's getting split up so many different ways between High Dive, between Amazon Prime, because a lot of Sentais...
Amazon's grabbing it, Hulu's grabbing it, Netflix are grabbing it. Like, everybody's grabbing a little bit, and it's weird, because for the longest time, you know, anime was one of those things that, like, anime fans knew where to get anime. Yeah. And now it feels like anime is becoming mainstream. And
it is. Which is a bad idea. Yeah.
But it's also becoming uncomfortable. Because then you have things like, you know, Western Hollywood versions of anime movies. And that is something I do not agree with.
Don't get me started on the Westerns trying to do anime. Neo Yokio, man. Don't get me started on that.
That is the
worst possible series ever. It should go die in a fire. I will bury the corpse.
The saving grace of that entire show is that it is the mind child of Jaden Smith. And, like, it makes sense being the mind child of Jaden. It's terrible. It's garbage. Yeah. But being a Jaden Smith creation somehow makes it better to me. I don't know why. Something about that makes it 10 times better. Like, I can stand it knowing, oh, yeah, this seems like something Jaden Smith would come up with.
Yeah, I mean, let's face it. Yeah, it would be. And this was just utter... Like, I looked at everything, and I was just like, it enrages me to see what studios were involved in it. And because there was a lot of really good animation, you know, anime studios involved with it. And it's just what we got was just... absolute nonsense. The problem is we're going to probably get season 2 of that.
You know, and I wouldn't be surprised. If he funds it, then he funds it, you know? Who's going to stop him?
Yeah.
They're getting paid to make anime, even if it's terrible.
I don't care. I will go to Hollywood. We're going to take a drive to Hollywood, and we're going to take him out.
I can stand a season 2 of Neo Yokio. What I can't stand are the live-action movies that are, like, slated to come out. Like,
see... The thing is, talking about live action here, is actually a really good thing here, too, because one thing that the Ghost in the Shell film, you're probably not a huge fan of that, that came out with Scarlett Johansson.
No.
It is actually going to be, it's part of the shortlist for visual effects category for the Academy. The Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences. Now, just bear with me here, man. Just bear with me. The film itself is an absolute beautiful film to look at. It is one of the saving graces of that film. Now, granted, does it hold up to the anime in any way? I don't think so. It's the one thing that Hollywood can't do, and I feel like it's – I don't know if it's the reasoning – I don't know what the reasoning behind it is, but a lot of different animes, you look at Ghost of the Shell, you even look at Your Name, have a lot of really good, quiet moments. And I just kind of look at Hollywood, and you just look at some of the films that come out, you really don't see many really good, quiet moments. Now, granted, you see some really good moments with, you know, Marvel, with different studios like Disney. Disney really knows how to do those really good, quiet moments. But you look at the mainstream... And, you know, you look at, you know, Warner Brothers, you look at Paramount, you know, all these other pictures, it just feels like they just don't know how to do that those quiet moments that anime is so well known for, because there's so many times
anime has a lot of moments that are storytelling through emotion. And I can guarantee you there's a good handful of actors that can do that. The problem is, how do you translate something like anime into live action? Like, it's one of those things. There's a lot of directors who will – or a good example. You've seen Kill Bill Part 1, right?
I have never seen Kill Bill.
Wow.
I know I'm making a shot for that one, but I've never seen it. Like, I've seen bits and pieces. I think I've seen bits and pieces of it because my cousins were watching it at one point, but...
Well, there's a scene where they basically use anime to explain the scene. And it was basically because, of all people, Quentin Tarantino couldn't find a way to translate this scene into live action. So he made it anime. So and like other directors have done the same thing, where they've taken animation and used it to translate something that they couldn't translate into English, because somehow in animation it makes sense. So how do you take an outlet that's used to making the most unusual moments plausible and try to translate that into an outlet that usually can't fathom the idea of, you know?
Yeah. Now, granted, though, there has been some really good moments, though, with, say, for instance, you look at Live, Die, Repeat. Absolutely phenomenal film. And based off of a manga. And it was really good. Like, I don't care what you say, man. It was just a really good film.
All right, so before someone says, oh, he doesn't like it because he doesn't like anime-related movies. Like, look, here's the thing. I saw that movie and didn't like it. I didn't realize till recently that it was based on a manga.
Yeah.
So before someone goes off, I did not know it was a manga, and I still didn't like it. It didn't catch me. I was like, no.
That's totally fair. Am I going to see this?
So, correct me if I'm wrong, but am I correct in assuming there's a Shin-Chan movie coming out? Because that is something that is ringing in my ear.
A Shin-Chan movie?
Yes. Because if so, that's something that needs to happen, like, last year.
Yeah, I think it's coming out this year, actually.
What I'm looking at says 2018, so it says April 2018.
All I'm seeing is something for 2017. I don't know. I mean, I was never a big fan of Shin-Chan.
I enjoyed Shin-Chan. I don't know. Shin-Chan always seemed like the right person took Tim and Eric jokes and made them work.
Yeah.
That's what Shin-Chan felt like to me. It felt like someone taking the Tim and Eric show and making it work.
Yeah, I guess it was always the art style that got away from me. It's like, I just never cared for it. For just the way it looked
like
and
the
everything.
Art style, it reassured me that nothing in this anime was going to be taken seriously, so I was completely okay with that.
Yeah, because I have no idea if there's going to be a new movie coming out for it. Now, granted, talking about anime movies, and probably one of the weirdest live-action twists. Now, granted, I really enjoyed the live-action Ghost in the Shell film because it was a visual wonder. Like, if you ever watch that movie, I would say just watch it for the visuals. It's amazing. The care they took for that series was really good. Now, this is other really weird, too. Now, Hollywood Reporter revealed on Wednesday that Ryan Reynolds' Deadpool will play the titular character Detective Pikachu in Legendary Entertainment's planned live-action Pokemon film.
Yo, I...
And I go, what?
That sounds like a grand idea.
I don't know whether that's a great idea or if it's a terrible idea. I just don't know why.
I was one of, like, the thousands of people who was seriously, like, hoping that Danny DeVito would say yes to everyone saying he'll play Pikachu. Because in my head, that sounds hilarious. So Ryan Reynolds is a good second for me. I'm completely with Ryan Reynolds playing that role.
I mean, the thing is, like, where are they going to go with it, though? Are they going to try to go R, or are they going to try to go keep it G? I don't know.
They kind of have to keep it G. It's not like Deadpool where it's expected to be R.
Oh, yeah.
Like, it's one of those things they kind of have to keep it G. So I think he can do G, and it'll still be funny. It's just, we know he can do funny. So now just, can he do funny at a G rating? Or at least a PG rating.
The problem is, I just don't know how good the movie's going to be. When it comes to anime and Hollywood, they don't really have a great track record.
No, they don't. Nope, not even a little.
It's either they don't understand
not
the...
even.
Ah, oh, man, there's like sometimes in some of the films, there's some really good moments in the films. Like, I want to say Death Note movie that came out with Netflix. There was some really good moments in there. Like the guy they've got to play L, he did an amazing job as L. But it's kind of how far it goes.
For me, you know, the big difference between, say, Hollywood doing anime and then doing, like, Marvel and DC films is one major thing. And that's that, at least with Marvel and DC, they have someone who understands the lore.
Yeah.
Working with the film people so that they could kind of meet in the middle somewhere. With anime, that's kind of hard to do because anime is really just all over the place. There's no company that they could just go to that they could grab someone and be like, hey, you understand anime. You're working for Hollywood as like a translator in a sense.
Yeah.
Like, you could argue, oh, well, they could grab someone from Funimation. Well, yeah, but at the same time, does Funimation understand it well enough that they could translate it in a movie?
I could tell you one thing Funimation could do, and there's a show that Funimation could translate to death. And I think because of the combination between Funimation and Sony Pictures now coming together, the one thing, really cool thing, we could actually have a really good live-action DBZ film if it's put in the hands of Funimation. Because they know... Okay, Funimation knows Dragon Ball Z. They know that universe. Like, if anybody knows that universe, I would say Funimation would know that universe way more than anybody else.
I agree, but I don't feel like DBZ is one of those shows that could translate into like a live action movie. Like, as terrible as it was, and let me state now that I do believe it was terrible.
Trust me, I raged multiple times. I watched that movie multiple times. Every time I watched it, I raged through it. I tried to make a spoof on it, and by the end of it, me and a friend of mine, we were just raging at the end.
Yeah, or if you ever get a chance, Nostalgia Critic and the guys from Team 4 Star do a review on it. If you ever get a chance to watch it,
I've watched it already.
All right. Well, as terrible as that movie is, that was what I felt like a Hollywood translation of that show would have been. Like, I don't feel like it's one of those shows that translates well into a Western audience. It has to have an Eastern, because one of the biggest issues I had with at least the Dragon Ball movie is that if you ever watch the Dragon Ball show, it is an anime translation of Monkey's Journey to the West. And because of Dragon Ball Z, that is kind of forgotten. So one of the biggest issues is that they basically tried to take that story and Westernize it. That was I feel like that's what a decent Hollywood translation of the Dragon Ball universe looks like to a Hollywood exec. And unfortunately, I don't feel like anyone at Funimation push any of the ideas that Dragon Ball would have well enough that they could translate into a decent movie. It just really doesn't work in my head.
I mean, you probably also right too, because there's just so much to cover, especially if you want to cover, you know, say you have so many movies. Granted, if you want to start from Dragon Ball when he's a little kid, now, granted, those movies would probably be R to some of the stuff that happens in the movie.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it's kind of interesting to see. What?
I was saying, like, they're pretty gory, like, all of them.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's ways you can cover up the gore, but still, there's only so much you could or you want to, you know, cover up, especially for...
No, like, if you're not going too far.
To tick off, you don't want to tick off DBZ fans. I mean, anime fans, you do not want to, because they're already going to be mad anyways. Even if they say, oh, live action film of X series. No!
No.
Now, granted, I would love to see live action remakes of anime. The only reason why is it gets people interested in anime, and they can maybe check out the source material and see that, oh, this is way better. Then this is better than the movie. I'll watch this instead and introduce them to anime.
It could happen. It's a hope. It's a hope. That's what that is.
I would love to see more people in anime. You definitely see that now with how anime has grown over the past, I would say over the past 4 years. I've been doing this podcast for about 4 years now, and from 2014 to now, there's been such a huge difference with not only simuldubs being a thing now. So you have simuldubs, you have bigger casts than before. So, like, in every one of the Funimations, especially going after Funimation there, you listen to any one of their dubs during the simulcast, more than likely, you will not hear the same voice more than once, which is an absolute great thing as an anime fan. And, you know, as a fan, that gets me excited because it like, means that we're not only going to get the old Funimation where it was like, oh, you know, you have Vic Mignogna as pretty much every character, or, you know, this character, that character, you know, what is his name? I'm trying to think of his name right now, and I can't, like, everybody, like, he's with DBZ, and I can't think of it right now, and it's like, oh my goodness. Not Sean Shamal, but the other guy. The guy who plays Vegeta.
Oh, shoot. I know this. I don't know why I know this.
Like, I know who he is, it's just I can't think of the name.
That plays Vegeta, right?
Yeah. It is... It's with Okatron. Wrong. Oh my goodness. What?
I was looking it up, and it gave me the Eastern cast, and I'm like, nope, I'm looking for the other group.
Yeah. Let's see here. Christopher Sabat.
There it is.
There we go. I don't know why I could not remember his name, but yeah, he was pretty much in pretty much everything as well. And we're not just getting that, which is great. And I love it.
Agreed, man, because like I know I talk anyone who knows me knows I talk mad shit about Vic Mignogna. And like, well, I do enjoy everything works, and I just think it's funny that he's in everything. Yeah. Like everything. Like anytime I'm like, oh hey, I'm slightly enjoying this anime. Here comes Vic. I'm like, wow, what are the odds?
Like, I mean, it kind of did with that a little bit there. When I first started getting into anime was really pretty much was starting off with, you know, Full Metal Alchemist, you know, then watched, what was the other series he was in? D&A Angel, which is another old one. And also,
yeah, man. That's one of the series I remember liking, and I remember not being able to tell people I liked it because of, like, it was very much a, like,
it's almost like as if it's not as bad as saying, oh, I really enjoy Fruits Basket, and being like, I don't want anyone knowing this.
Yeah, D&A Angel was one of those series. Like, D&A Angel and like Orin High School Host Club were like those two series for me that I just couldn't tell people. Yeah, I enjoyed it.
Yeah. Orin High School Host Club, I always told people I loved it. I don't think I ever had a series that I really just did not want anybody to know I watched. Maybe Cardcaptor Sakura. Now it's like, I don't care. Because Cardcaptor Sakura is just...
Amazing.
It's been a while since I've actually watched it, but it's really darn good.
Yeah, agreed.
And granted, I kind of want to buy it, but I want to buy it from the old dub. And now granted, if Funimation actually redubs it in English, redubs the entire series, I'll absolutely love it because it's one of those weird series that goes hand in hand with Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles.
Okay.
And because it's really weird. The end of Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles, I read the manga on it, and it's such a jacked up series. like I'm serious. Like, you want to have a complete mind screw over, man? Oh my goodness. I was reading the end of Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles and absolutely enjoying it, and then finding out X-Person's father, and X-Person is... No, wait, what? You're its mother's father's sons? Daughters? What?
Yeah, what, no, what see, I don't see that. I don't need that headache in my life.
It's great. It's an absolute what the crap ending. Because, I don't know, Clamp is one of those interesting people. Like, interesting not developers, but, like, studio. It's just a very interesting studio that I can't, they make really good stuff. And the fact that Reservoir Chronicles, you know, kind of put all of their stuff together and kind of weaved everything together in a very weird way that really works, and dang it. Granted, that's another series, though, because we're getting more of Cardcaptor Sakura. I'm hoping that means we're going to get more of Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles, because I need more of that. Like, we got to pretty much close to the end of where they were in OVAs and where they were in the manga, and it's like, I need this to continue. Just continue it, Reservoir Chronicles. I need to see this weird thing shape up in the anime and be like, this is weird and awesome at the same time. And be just completely, I don't even know. Like, even right now, I can't tell you exactly, you know, what it is that makes it just a weird, weird thing. Because it's like, I don't want to give the ending of Reservoir Chronicles away, but it's just, it's so weird because it's dealing with Cloud. Yeah, because you're actually dealing with, in Reservoir Chronicles, you're dealing with Cloud. And it's the same Cloud who has the Cloud cards.
Man.
So.
Let's just wait until the whole thing comes to a head and next year when Cardcaptors comes back.
I mean, Cardcaptor Sakura, Clear, will probably not go through that. I doubt they're going to even go, you know, maybe they might touch on a little bit of Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles, but I'm really doubting it. Just because of the fact that where it takes place in, I think where it takes place in, where they actually pick it up, I think is when, after she graduates high school, I believe.
Well, I mean, I thought it was going to wrap it all up, though.
I have no idea if Clear's going to wrap it up. I've no idea. I'm assuming it might actually just wrap up the entirety of the Cardcaptor Sakura series, which if that does it, and then we find out that their kid, you know, her and Shaoran have a kid named Shaoran, and finding out that the Shaoran that they have is a Shaoran that's actually a clone of the Shaoran. Who basically... Oh, and basically finding out both Shaoran, you have a Shaoran that's a clone, and then you have a Sakura that's a clone. I think is a clone. As I said, like, going through this in my head, you guys are witnessing me literally going crazy. At one point, I'm going to have to show you that ending of that book, and I'm going to have to, you know, show you exactly what I mean by just, like, because I don't know if you've ever watched any of, Tsubasa Reservoir Chronicles.
Oh, God.
I mean, the series itself, the anime itself is not like that at all. Now, granted, it does have some twists and turns in it, but it's not anything like the manga, especially the ending. The ending of that manga is just the... I could probably talk about it for a while. Okay, so moving on.
All right, one series I do know that is going to end next year. It the whole thing wraps up, from what I'm understanding.
What, One Piece?
Fairy Tale.
Oh, yeah,
close.
Fairy Tale.
We're close. That is a close guess.
You know, the one hope is that One Piece is going to be ending soon. That way, everybody who's
Never.
Watching One Piece, they're, okay, once One Piece ends, the anime ends, you do realize there will be a collective sigh of relief around the entire world.
I don't know if it's going to be a sigh of relief or just like, what do we do now?
Yeah.
It's going to be just a collective of people asking, what do we do now? There's no more.
Very true. No more One Piece. Yeah. What do you do after that? Like, after years.
Yeah, Fairy Tale comes to an end next year. I do know that. I've heard that one 100 times. Of course, Sword Art's going to keep going. Oh my God, why?
Sword Art is... This is the one thing I do have to say. Sword Art, the original Sword Art series, I actually really enjoy the first Sword Art online. I really do still enjoy it. Now, granted, mind you, after they get out of Ironcrad and go into the ferry area, that is where it really kind of starts derailing itself.
That's where it starts derailing. Okay.
It's kind of like it starts derailing itself before that, but really kind of when it goes off the rails a little bit is in that series. Granted, I still really kind of enjoy it because I kind of enjoyed, you know, Kirito as a character and, you know, Asuna, all that stuff. Okay. You know, I kind of enjoyed it, but the thing is, Sword Art Online 2, you go into Sword Art Online 2, and it's still, you know, it's like, yeah, I get to go back and, you know, watch these characters that you kind of like. Yeah, okay, I'm dealing with it. And it went on too long. Sword Art Online 2 went too long. They tried to extend it way too much than they shouldn't have extended it. And it dragged.
I couldn't
really
make
horribly.
Past part one, my friend. I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it.
Yeah. The thing is about Kirito, and the reason what they were doing with it was actually decent enough, was when they were actually making him very relatable in episode 3. Of the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. That's what it's called. And
that's
it's
the one where
his
entire squad dies, right?
He just utterly breaks down. And he has that humanity in him. And it's a great episode. It's a great, not only a great episode, but it's also a great Christmas episode. We actually have done a video of Annie Semper on that as well. Talking about that episode, because it's just a great episode to watch. Because it's a part of where SAO was trying to show the fact that there was all this disparity.
What's
and
up?
If they would have killed off Sword Art, not killed off Sword Art, but if they would have killed off Kirito, or one of the main characters, I think it could have really worked. I think it could have gone somewhere, but because the fact that they weren't going to kill off any of the main cast, it kind of took away the suspense of Sword Art. And the fact that no one's going to die. And that's kind of where it really did derail itself. And the fact that, you know, you go to Sword Art Online 2 that has... Yeah.
Like, everything was kind of a derail for me. The marriage thing, the whole, you know, death's not really a problem now since I'm a hacker and I can hack the game. And the icing on the icing on the cake, I'm sorry, was... What did you do it all for? You know, I don't even remember. Like, at that point, I was like, I'm done with the series. I am so done with the series. Like, at that point, I gave it the college try, got to the end, and was like, nope, table flip, I'm out.
I can totally understand that. I can totally respect that. Because a lot of people, you know, it's like, oh, Sword Art Online is absolute trash. You know, I don't know how people can actually like it. I can see the appeal of it. It's... not only because people like to bash it because it's a, you know, very popular series, but it's also not a very well-done popular series. And it has a lot of flaws. Even though it does have a lot of flaws, I think it has a lot of fun times in there, too. And I think that's what really kind of gets to me is that it's fun to watch. It's one of those series is that it's probably, for me personally, a guilty pleasure of mine.
You know, I can't judge you for that, but I still think that show is hot trash.
that show is hot trash.
I'm telling you. I got mad at the ending. I was like, are you serious? There was literally no point to any of this. And utterly, the villain was just like, nope.
I mean, I can totally see that. People getting jaded by that.
I would have been so much happier if he was just like, you know what? I was bored. Like, that would have been a better ending than I don't remember.
I don't remember, man. I killed thousands and thousands of young kids, and I don't remember why I did this.
I was bored.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I would have been so much happier if he was just like, you know what? I was bored. I was bored. I had a video game to my control, and I had a lot of young minds I could miss. I was bored. Like, I'd have been so happy with that.
Which is something that I do have to say is that was really funny, and it's something that I really enjoy, is the Sword Art Online Abridged. That is done by...
I enjoyed the Abridged series 100 times more than
witty,
I enjoyed the original
something
series.
Witty. I think it's called Something Witty This Way It Comes, I think. It's by...
Is it?
It's something witty. I know that.
All I know is, like, I enjoyed the Abridged series 100 times more than I enjoyed the actual series itself.
Yeah, it's something witty entertainment. Stunned by that. And they did an absolutely amazing job at that. And it's in a way, it's a better story than the original SAO, which, you know.
It really was. It really was. It was a better story. It was told, like, I enjoyed the Abridged series. I could not say the same for the original.
Yeah, which I know there's a lot of people out there that, you know, it's like, we're talking about SAO. I know. But hey, who doesn't want to talk about SAO? You know, it brings in the views, you know.
Okay. I would rather talk about Attack on Titan, and I hate Attack on Titan.
Oh, man, Attack on Titan. God, man, you've just come to the wrong show, man, because I love Attack on Titan.
Oh, I'm sorry. I hate Attack on Titan. I'm sorry. What Attack on Titan has the ability to do is it could literally be a Monster of the Week kind of episode where, you know, giant monster comes in, they kill it, you know, next episode, new giant monster. Like, almost like the original Power Rangers used to do. Every week it was a different monster, different trial that had to complete. Attack on Titan has that opportunity.
Yeah.
And it waits the opportunity, and then at the same time has the nerve to have the most boring cast. Like the characters themselves are just boring characters.
Yeah.
I do not like any of them. I don't care what happens to any of them. And that is the biggest issue.
You know, the one thing, though, yeah.
But if you're going to have an anime, at least make me care about the characters.
Yeah. But at least, though, you have to admit, though, is that you can try all you want. I don't think Armin is going to be killed off any soon. Even though they've killed off a lot of people in that show, though. There's not a lot of people. They've killed off, quite a few people in that series so far. I mean, it's getting a third season, which I'm kind of excited for. I know you're just kind of like, whatever, just let it die.
Nope.
And fire.
Let it die. Let it die. Oh, my God, let it die. It has so much potential, and I'm not gonna waste that on a show. Attack on Titan has all the potential in the world, but if you're going to have a meh show, at least give me some interesting characters. Give me characters to care about.
Yeah.
I don't care what happens to any of those people. And that's my biggest issue with that show.
Yeah, I mean, that's
genuinely
definitely
don't care.
Mm-hmm. Especially with a show like Attack on Titan, where
Titan
be like, no, don't kill him. He was my favorite naked guy.
Right? God, yeah. Like, it might take a while for you to kill off some characters, but if it's a character I like, I'm going to remember that moment. I don't remember any of these characters. I don't like them.
There was I would say there's a ton of really good moments, and I don't think there's really that many, you know, great moments where I thought, oh my goodness, you know, it's like, I thought it was, actually, I did kind of gasp a little bit when it's like, because, oh wow, they actually killed off Aaron, and then he came back, and it was just like, oh, that's kind of interesting. He became back, became a big Titan, and it was like, this mystery, I just want to know what's in that basement. I don't think season 2 gave us what's in the basement.
Oh, well, you know, season 3 is coming.
I know.
Coming in 2018, July.
The problem is that I got to find out what's in that basement. Like, I don't care about anything else. I want to know what's in that dang basement. They like, go, we got to get to the basement. We got to get to the basement. If there's nothing
now,
in that basement,
well, see, now what's
going to
happen is,
that,
what's going to happen now is you're not going to find out, because if you find out, you might stop watching. So they're not going to tell you now.
Or it's just a big sign that says, we just trolled you.
Yeah.
They
yeah,
just literally go down there, and it's just, that's it. That would be the best. I would have to admit, if they just admit to just messing with you, and there's nothing in that basement, I would be like, okay. I will stay with you on this one, because that's actually kind of funny.
but knowing is half the battle for you. Just want to know.
Kind of. It's one of those things where they put a lot of this pressure on. Granted, season 2 is yet to come out on DVD yet. Now, granted, one of my big purchases was Attack on Titan. When I got the original Attack on Titan on Blu-ray DVD combo, I got it both for $30. Black Friday.
You're not gonna get season two for $30. At least not year. Maybe next year.
I don't know when actually. I don't know even know when Funimation's releasing that actually.
Probably shortly after season three is finally released.
No, they're not waiting that long. Funimation won't wait that long. They're not that evil.
You don't think they're gonna wait that long? All
right. Funimation is not that evil. I mean,
anime series.
Yeah.
Oh my bad. What?
Funimation is just not that evil. Now, you're saying?
Oh. I'll say there are two anime series I see on this list that coming out next year that I am particularly interested in. One of which is Persona 5, the animation, because if I'm lazy as I think I am, I might just wait for the animation and not play Persona 5. And that was terrible. But
the one thing that would be actually really cool, though, if the animation, if they get all the same voice cast.
That for the probably English. Won't happen, but it would be interesting. That would be interesting, but I doubt that.
It is very possible, though, because the thing is, it all depends on who gets it. But even if the person that gets it, like say if it's Aniplex that gets it, which it probably won't more likely be, if it gets a dub, more than likely it will be, because all that cast is in L.A.
Well, we'll see what happens. Hopefully Aniplex gets it. The other one for me, and it's another one that I kind of don't like letting people know I like because people look at me funny, High School DxD Hero.
I'm sorry, but High School DxD is, oh my goodness. You know like what? I know why you like High School DxD.
No, you and don't.
I will tell you that it's because of all the characters' personalities.
Yeah, okay, you do get it. one is the personalities. I do actually enjoy each character. And then two, I'm a sucker for anything with like religious conflict. And so High School DxD, the first part kind of brought that, you know, God versus demons kind of thing. And I'm like, ooh, interest. But I also am very aware, it is hard to ignore that the show is chock full of fan service. And I can't honestly ignore that and you know, feel right. But I will say I can look past the fan service and enjoy the show. But I have to at least man up and admit that it's there.
Yeah. I mean, there's another show that I like that has that fan service. It's Gotta HK Yamada's First Time. Absolutely fantastic show. Ton of fan service. It's almost, it's almost Sentai.
You're the only other person I've been watching that.
Yeah, it's a great show. It's fantastic. The premise is basically, for anybody out there wondering what the heck is this premise, the premise of it is this girl in high school wants to become the class slut. That's the premise.
the greatest thing about that show, and I still think it's one of the greatest endings ever, because at the end of the show, they still don't do it.
Yeah,
she comes to terms with the fact that, like, yeah, I kind of like this guy. And, like, they leave it at that. Like, at the end of the show, as much fan service
feel bad
as
for
is,
him, though.
She still never actually does it. And, like, that was kind of, like, comforting. Like, I was very okay with that. Like, I almost didn't want them to do it for, like, the longest time. I was like, it doesn't feel right.
But at the end of that show, I felt bad for him, though. So many times over, he had to look around his shoulder to make sure she's not there.
Yeah, I agree. But just the fact that they both came to the realization that they want to date each other, and it's not just sex. Like, that was the way to end that.
Yeah, which is actually something really kind of interesting, too, is that when you look at, you know, any type of relationship, and I think it's actually a great show to probably show to somebody that is thinking about getting into a relationship and, you know, thinking about it, because with Hollywood, it's all about sex. Let's just face it. It's all about that. It's all about, you know, love, all that crap, you know, and everything. But
right,
really,
we couldn't make it through a Wonder Woman without her getting laid, so, like, you're not wrong.
Yeah. But, I mean, Wonder Woman is really good, though, too. I have to admit. One of the best DC movies to come out in a while, and that's not really saying much, but but
I like DC. Yeah. Right now.
Oh yeah. I mean, I heard really good things with Justice League, so I'm hoping it's on the right track. When you look at Bigara HK Yamba's first time, is that it does go into, yeah, they try to get into the physical and the weird aspects of the nasty thing that is sex. I mean, sex is probably the nastiest thing any human being could ever possibly ever do, and they kind of,
I don't know
really
about it being
show
nasty,
that.
But it is weird.
Yeah, it is weird, and like, what you're saying, it's kind of just, it's just icky. It kind of can be very icky, in a sense, if that makes sense. I know it's like sounds like a little kid going, ew, that's icky, and finding out about it, but yeah. It kind of shows into the, not only just doing it just to do it, but having it, doing it because you really feel a connection with that person, that you don't have just a lust for that person, not only a physical attraction, but you have a mental and kind of that spiritual attraction to that person that you kind of know.
Yeah, it's almost like saying, like, yo, it's okay. Like, yeah, sex is weird. Just like, it's almost like, yeah, yeah. Just look, sex is a weird thing. Admit it. So, yeah. I see where you're coming from.
Yeah, and it's like it's this weird kind of thing. But granted, she does not change throughout. She does change throughout the entire series. That's what's really interesting too, is that you see her character change. Even though her outside character doesn't really change that much, she's still a what do you call those things that, you know, the virgin whores. There we go. She's still a virgin whore, but. She does have, but her character has gone through.
She comes to terms with, like, maybe I don't want to be like a slut. She kind of comes to that.
Yeah.
Like, don't get me wrong. I want this kid's virginity, but I think I just want his virginity. I'm like,
okay. Yeah.
it's very much like she takes it from, I want to do all of them to, I just want to do this one a lot.
Yeah. I mean, originally, I mean, I don't blame her. I mean, as much trouble as it is just for this one person, I don't really blame her for just giving up on one, just going, sticking with one person, because she finds out that, oh, this is not as easy as I thought this was going to be.
So, I see. Bro.
And series that are coming out, and the series that are coming out next year is My Hero Academia Season 3 is coming out. Oh my goodness, yes, I'm more My Hero Academia. And on top of that, Full Metal Panic Invisible Victory is coming back. Oh, Full Metal Panic, I've missed you.
I have a confession to make.
Yeah,
I
have
not caught up on My Hero Academia. I am very much waiting. I'm very much waiting on the dub. And the reason being is because I watched the first season both subbed and dubbed, and I enjoyed the dub more.
Mm-hmm.
So, fortunately, I can't switch. I can't keep bouncing back and forth between the two. So I'm going to stick with the dub, and I'm waiting for them to dub season two. Once they do that, I will catch
it. Season two, I think, is fully dubbed, actually.
Is it?
Yeah, because they did a simul dub of it.
Okay, well, it wasn't simul dub because the sub was up for like a good couple months, and then I stopped checking.
Yeah.
But if it's done, I'll check it. I'll check.
Now. So on Funimation Now or Verve, it should have the dub of My Hero Academia for season two. Because I know I was watching that one dubbed, and I think I kind of get under that same way where it's like I start watching it. You know, it's like I started watching the dub and be like, okay, I want to continue the dub, not the sub, even though I really enjoy.
Yeah, like,
both. I enjoy both absolutely immensely, and the style that they use, the comic book style, is an amazing style.
Yeah, like, I'm not one of those people who's like, oh, I need to watch it subbed because subbed is better, and blah, 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 blah. Like, no, like, let's be realistic. I don't feel like reading subtitles sometimes, so I'll watch it dubbed, and if I like the, if I just happen to like the sub voices more, then yeah, I'll watch it subbed. But if I like the dub version, I'm going to stick with dub because I just don't feel like reading subtitles sometimes.
Oh, yeah. I mean, not only do you get the ever so great Christopher Sabat as All Might, which is just absolutely beautiful thing. Absolutely love it.
Yeah.
But you also get Justin Briner as the main lead, and he is absolutely phenomenal. Granted, I've become more and more of a fanboy for him, though.
I will say, I will give the subs All Might its props, because I did like the sub one better. Like, He was very entertaining every time he was on screen. And while I do like the dub one, the sub one was just, he was better.
You just felt that, yeah. It's kind of like, I think along the same lines as for me, Assassination Classroom. Because when I watched the sub, it was really good, but, I forget his name, Sonny Strait, interpret, basically him doing the character of the teacher there. I can't remember his name. Oh, why can't I? Koro Sensei. Of Koro Sensei is the fact that. Of Koro Sensei is that his was just absolutely hilarious every single time. And it just never came across as funny in the sub as it did in the dub.
Yeah.
And I don't know why.
Okay, yeah.
It was one of those weird things where it's just like a subtlety there. It's just like, I don't know why that is. But unfortunately, I think that's all the time we got today. So thank you guys so much for listening and so much for watching. And as always, if you guys want to check out more of this coming your way, and you know, we'll be back next week, and it's going to be even better and bigger than ever. I don't know better and bigger, but yeah, but we will be good. King Koopa here will be with me all the way to the end, I think, hopefully. As long as, you know, the chains don't break. We'll be good.
Chains shouldn't break. Yeah.
Sweet! I don't even know where I was going with this.
As much as possible.
I don't even know where I'm going with this ending.
I will try to be here until you're sick of it.
Sweet! Which is never. You are with me now! Okay, so with that being said, guys, thank you so much for watching, and as always, I'll see you, and also, if you guys want to hit that subscribe button, you know, for the Epic Awesome Show, if you want to link to this on YouTube or VidMe, definitely hit that subscribe button to hear more stuff coming down the pipeline, because there's stuff coming from, I'm trying to think here, stuff, you know, interviews that are going to be coming up here shortly from Anime North Texas, there we go, that's the anime, that's the convention I went to last time. Anime North Texas 2017, so definitely be on the lookout for that. And as always, I'm Zane, and this is...
Epic Awesome Show. Yeah.
Your name. Okay, and as always, and I'll see you guys on the flip side.